Bishop Hill was one of several religious colonies that dotted the landscape in mid-19th century America. Like most religious colonies, Bishop Hill was created as a place where the devout could work their way towards spiritual perfection.
The founder of the Bishop Hill colony was a Swedish pietist named Erik Jansson. Jansson believed that he had been cured of severe rheumatism by praying for and receiving divine healing. Soon after that, Jansson began to preach and teach his own brand of religion. His powerful personality and great speaking ability attracted a growing band of followers. To some, including himself, Jansson was believed to be the second coming of Christ.
That, combined with Jansson's contempt for the teaching and hierarchy of the state Lutheran Church, put him in a collision course with the Swedish government. For a time, Jansson was imprisoned for his beliefs.
Jansson and his followers ended their conflict with the state Lutheran Church by immigrating to America. The Bishop Hill community was organized and planned before the Jansenists left Sweden. Jansson's followers liquidated all of their assets. The group included skilled workers, wealthy farm owners and businessmen, and ordinary peasant farmers.
One historian noted, Jansson's power over them was extraordinary. In obedience to his word, 1,100 people had abandoned their homes in a prosperous country to found new ones in the wilderness. They braved unknown dangers and suffered untold hardships.
Erik Jansson arrived in Illinois in 1846 and was soon joined by a group of his followers. After a three-month ocean voyage and a journey across the Great Lakes, the immigrant settlers walked 160 miles from Chicago to Henry County. When they arrived in the fall of 1846, a representative of Jansson had already bought land. The colonists dug crude half-cave and half-timber living quarters into the side of a ravine.
Jansson ordered fast days when food was scarce, telling the colonists to substitute faith for food. Utopia didn't come without sacrifice. The first winter, 96 Jansenists died.
No photographs or visual images of Erik Jansson are known to exist. Jansson was the sole, unquestioned leader of his flock. He supervised all the colony's activities. He preached sermons, invested the colony's money, bought land, and even found markets for the colony's farm products and manufactured goods.
When the Bishop Hill colony was at its zenith, people said that, from the top of the Bjorklund Hotel Tower, all the land you could see in every direction belonged to the colony. 14,000 acres were owned by the colony, over 21 square miles. Several thousand acres were under cultivation.
Jansson knew the colony had to make money to survive. In a letter he wrote from St. Louis in 1850, he said, "You should make wagons, as many as possible. I have sent home iron for about 30. As soon as possible, plows should be made to be sold. 2,000 rugs can be sold in this city."
The Swedes of Bishop Hill adapted to the business and industry of the New World extremely well. They embraced the new technologies of their time, always looking for ways for machines to reduce manual labor. They built a sawmill and made furniture. They fired bricks, made wagons, buggies, and farm implements. They grew flax, wove rugs, and milled grain for themselves and the surrounding area.
They were the first people in the county to have a steam engine. Their blacksmith shop had steam power and a metal turning lathe. Colonist Eric Olson wrote, "It is a busy place. We trade everything people want. The Americans come in droves. It surprises them that we can live together like this."
From the beginning, Bishop Hill was extremely important to the economy of Henry County. One scholar writes, "From 1846 to 1850, in the purchase of land and necessities, Bishop Hill put between $10,000 and $15,000 in gold into circulation at a time when business was conducted by barter."
In 1851, the colony began to cultivate broom corn. The first 6 acres were planted and sold in Peoria for $50 a ton. Soon, they were making their own brooms. The Pleasant Hill Shakers of Kentucky sold the Jansenists their first broom-making equipment. In 1857, the colony sold a single order of 14,000 brooms in St. Louis.
As one would expect, the first permanent building at Bishop Hill was the church. Because people needed places to live, the basement and first floor each contained family living quarters. There were 10 rooms on each floor, one family per room. Adults worked 14 to 16 hours a day. All food was prepared in the communal kitchens. Everyone ate in the communal dining hall. A single room for sleeping was all the family needed.
The upstairs sanctuary seated about 1,000 people. The plain furnishings reflect the Jansenist belief in religious simplicity. Church services were held the first thing every morning and the last thing every night. As was the custom with some faiths, a center divider separates the seating of men and women.
Visitors to the colony were encouraged. Some Illinois citizens were suspicious of powerful and charismatic religious leaders and the communities they led. The Jansenists wanted to assure the surrounding population they had nothing to fear.
Very early on, Bishop Hill encouraged visits by outside merchants and businessmen. From the beginning, the colony was providing hotel accommodations. The Bjorklund Hotel was built in 1852. It was named after Sven Bjorklund, one of the hotel's managers. Among other things, Bjorklund was a clockmaker. One traveler wrote, "Mr. Bjorklund is a genius. He constructed a very neat and accurate timepiece for the sitting room of the hotel, and also a clock for the cupola of the large edifice on the hill, the steeple building. He can make a clock. Every wheel, shaft, axle, pulley, dial plate, index, and whatnot. Unless some accident occurs, the town clock of his construction will be running in good order for 100 years.
At the height of its success, Bishop Hill had about 1,000 residents and over 20 permanent buildings. One of the most impressive structures was known as the Big Brick. The Big Brick was a pair of four-story apartment buildings that were each 45 feet wide and 100 feet long. Most of the colonists lived there. It had 96 one-room apartments. The communal dining hall was on the lower level. Several hundred people could eat here at the same time. In its day, the Big Brick was reputed to be the largest brick building west of Chicago.
In 1850, Eric Jansen was murdered over a dispute involving the marriage of a Jansenist woman to a non-Jansenist man named John Root. After Jansen's death, the colony was governed by 7 trustees.
Over the next 10 years, a national economic depression and a series of bad investments of colony money contributed to the decline, as did the coming of the Civil War. When the able-bodied men of Bishop Hill joined the army and went off to fight for the Union, there were not enough people left to do the work.
The Bishop Hill colony formally dissolved in 1861. All of the communal property was divided among the colonists. According to Eric Johnson, Jansen's son, the total value of the property divided was nearly $600,000. Dividing the property was extremely complicated. Among other things, they tried to take into account how long individuals had been in the colony and how old they were. It took nearly 12 years to legally dissolve the colony. The way the farmland was divided created peculiarities with boundaries and easements that still affect land transactions today.
Some of what we know about life at Bishop Hill comes from the paintings of Olaf Kranz. Kranz was a 12-year-old boy when he and his parents arrived from Sweden in 1850. By that time, thousands of acres of farmland were in production, and the community was producing enough grain and textiles to sell.
Kranz was one of the colony's young men who left to serve in the Union Army during the Civil War. He came back to the area, raised a family, and worked as a house painter. Kranz began to paint scenes of old Bishop Hill from his boyhood memories and the memories of former colonists.
Kranz's soft-toned primitive style and attention to detail have made him a nationally recognized folk artist. A collection of his work is on display in the Bishop Hill Museum. His paintings evoke the spirit of the Bishop Hill colony and its Jansenist founders.
Kranz was particularly interested in the people of Bishop Hill. His portraits far outnumber other works. The stern faces in his paintings show people with determination and resolve, and a sameness that reflects this philosophy of communal living.
Over 1,000 Swedish immigrants came to the United States to join the Bishop Hill colony. The experiment in religious utopianism at Bishop Hill wasn't a success, nor was it a complete failure.
As the years have passed, the Bishop Hill Old Settlers Association, the Bishop Hill Heritage Association, the state of Illinois, and private citizens have all contributed to the continuing preservation of Bishop Hill.
The spirit of the preservation effort was best expressed by Bishop Hill colonist and trustee Jonas Olson. "It would be a great comfort if we in our old age could be spared the destruction that has recently threatened us, and if our descendants, after we have gone to our fathers, had nobler things to view when looking back on bygone days than a ruined place intended as a dwelling for the people of God.